This was a huge week for President Obama on many fronts. Ultimately, it may be remembered most as the week he went there on race. In Charleston, Friday, delivering a eulogy for Reverend Clementa Pinckney, killed in the vicious attack at the Emmanuel AME Church. And in a garage in Los Angeles, days earlier, in an unfiltered interview with podcaster Mark Maron, using a word we're not used to hearing from a president. It's been downloaded more than 1.5 million times in the past week, a huge hit for a podcast. Now, activist and author Cornel West is the perfect person to talk with about the president's newfound candor. We began by looking at how the networks, all the TV networks, were stymied by one simple question: to bleep or not to bleep.
Racism, we are not cured of.
Clearly.
And it's not just a matter of it not being polite to say nigger in public, to say nigger in public. That's not the measure of whether racism still exists or not.
There is something so strange about the bleeping of the word in all of those clips. Only I think CNN and CBS decided to air it unbleeped.
Well, I mean, the problem is that you've got the long history of denial, of coming to terms with the vicious legacy of white supremacy.
So you think when it's bleeped, that's denial?
Oh, absolutely. But you may have denial even when he says it. You have to come to terms with what he's talking about. What does he mean by nigger? What does it mean to keep people afraid and scared and intimidated, to keep black people thinking we are less intelligent, less beautiful? And of course, in the name of that is to make sure we're still dominated, to make sure our minds still have slave mentalities. When we reach the point, my dear brother, when we understand that the legacy of white supremacy is a matter of national security, it's a matter of truth, and the condition of truth is to allow suffering to speak, and it's a matter of justice. Justice relates to a variety of different issues. Racism, of course, is the one issue that can do what? Bring the curtain down on America. Should have been talking about it for 7 years. I'm glad that the president now is beginning to speak about it much more consistently.
He certainly instigated a lot of discussion this week, and yet a lot of it was about the word. Did you feel that the larger meaning got lost?
In a way it did, but in a certain sense too. Once you start talking about the flags and recognize it's not just a matter of region. You've got good brothers and sisters of various colors in the South, West, Midwest, East, but the legacy of white supremacy is systemic. Now, the president said a few months ago in regard to Ferguson, what? Racism is not endemic. That's a lie, Mr. President. It is endemic.
Why would
it
he say
systemic.
That, then? Why?
Political calculation. Hmm. He's afraid of Fox News. He's afraid of right wing. He thinks they're going to attack him. They're going to attack you anyway, Mr. President. Stand for truth. Stand for justice. That's the legacy of John Coltrane.
You're saying perhaps he pays too much attention to Fox News.
He's a politician. He needs to stand up out of moral conviction. Ella Baker and Fannie Lou Hamer didn't struggle for nothing. Nina Simone didn't sing for nothing. Donny Hathaway didn't move our souls for nothing. They were talking about truth, justice, and how do we relate to each other as human beings.
Can I play a soundbite for you from 20 years ago? I was so struck by this when we found this other day. This is President Clinton in 1995 speaking at a Congressional Black Caucus dinner.
But in every country, forces of extremism have a stronger voice than they have had in years. You see it in a bomb blowing up the federal building in Oklahoma City. And you see it in more subtle ways, yes, even in America. Like when five children in an upper-class suburb in this country write the hated word nigger in code word in their school albums.
Now, we checked, and that got so much less attention 20 years ago than the president saying the same word did this week. Is it because of a different kind of media we have now, a social and digital media? Or is it because the president's black? Or are there other reasons why you think it gets so much more attention this time?
Well, part of it is that Obama, of course, being a brilliant and charismatic black president, neoliberal mode, and the fact that you got a social movement on the ground, you got courageous and visionary, marvelously militant young black, brown, red young people, Ferguson, Staten Island, and so forth. It's in the context of an emerging social movement, mm-hmm. And then you get a black president saying it. You are going to get a lot of attention. But as you rightly say, it's not just about the word; it's about how does it get us to come to terms with the truth about America? Founded on white supremacy, indigenous people's land taken, their babies and women violated, enslaved Africans for over 80 years under the U.S. Constitution, unbelievable terrorism and torture, and yet out of that, what have black folk done? We've taught the world in the face of hate how better to love. Look at the response of the precious black folk who were murdered. Teach the world something about love in the face of that kind of hatred. That is what Martin King, that's what John Coltrane's Love Supreme, that's what Marvin Gaye's What's Going On, that's what Fannie Lou Hamer's about. But you got to listen to the love, and of course love is not just proclaimed, it has to be enacted.
There was so much talk about forgiveness in the immediate days after the massacre in Charleston. More conversation about forgiveness than I think we might have heard if they'd had white skin.
Yeah, but I think the problem of talk about forgiveness too early is that it still makes white folk the major point of reference. It was love of black people as the basis of love of others. The greatness of black people have been that we've refused to hate in the face of hate. Emmett Till's mother said what? I don't have a minute to hate. I will pursue justice all my life. She didn't say, I forgive prematurely. Because once you talk about forgiveness, you're talking about the white folk who did it. And so you're making white folks center stage again, you see. The love that flows to the vanilla side of town begins on the chocolate side of town. That's what was coming through in those magnificent witnesses. And I believe that forgiveness is a long process. It's not an utterance. So somebody raped your mother, you're not going to forgive them the next day. You got to work that through. But the important thing is you're not going to hate. And so you just contribute to more hate. That's part of the genius of the best of the black freedom struggle.
Sounds like you're not ready to declare mission accomplished. Far from
it. Never. We got a long way to go. We just got to keep smiles on our faces and love in our hearts, but also be willing to fight. We forgive, yes, but we also fight, my brother. Got to be love warriors, justice warriors.
Do you see enough folks on television fighting? Do you see enough people on cable news making the points you're making, or do you feel it's too marginalized?
It is too marginalized. You know, you really do. You got MSNBC, you know, it's basically Obama propaganda. You got Fox News, right-wing propaganda. CNN, much more ambiguous, able to generate some insights, wrestling with some issues like your show, but still CNN fearful because you got to deal with the profit margin. You got to deal with making money. Amy Goodman, very good.
But
Democracy News tell the truth.
But conversations like this rate. So how are you saying it's about profit margin, that that's a risk for a CNN, for example?
Well, but how many conversations do you have like this on CNN? You know what I mean?
Well, I feel like we're coming off the week with almost nonstop discussion of race and other issues.
No, you got
culminating
in Friday's
discussions
of black people and black faces, but I'm talking about telling the truth. Truth is not connected to skin color.
On that note, Dr. West, thank you for being here.
You stay strong, my brother.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.